Hello. Good afternoon or good evening, whatever the case may be, wherever I find you there. Thank you for allowing me into your home and hearing my stories, looking at my pictures, and see if we can have a little fun together. My name is Pete Willcox. I'm lovingly referred to as America's TV Elvis. How about that for a title? And, you know, I don't remember if I gave that to myself or a friend of mine did, but it was because I was very blessed in the 70s and 80s, getting a lot of TV work. I got Cheers, Designing Women, Murphy Brown, L.A. Law, Full House, Alf. But the real big deal for me, the breakthrough, was when I was chosen to do Elvis's voice for Happy Days. If you've ever seen that show, and it's a real fun one, some of you guys aren't old enough to remember, and I don't like most of you for that. But Fonzie is one of an American icon. He's so cool. He's America's favorite leather jacket guy. And he would hang at the malt shop, and he'd bang the jukebox. He'd kick it, and he'd get a free play. And usually it was Elvis, and usually it was Hound Dog. Well, that wasn't Elvis. That was me. I got to do that. I was chosen for that. And for the first 20 years of my Elvis career, I was the voice of Elvis from Laverne and Shirley and Happy Days. And what's fun about that is that Elvis heard it one day, and he was watching. Fonzie did his game, and he said, as only he can do, "Hey, man, I wonder if I'm getting paid for that." And Charlie Hodge said to him, "That's not you, boss. That's that kid you met at Schwab's drugstore." He goes, "What? Man, that's good, man. I thought that was me." Now let me tell you the Schwab's drugstore. I was working at a nightclub right next door. It's the famous drugstore where Lana Turner was discovered. I was working there, and I took a break, and I went into a magazine rack, and I'm looking at a magazine, you know, kind of like this. Warren Beatty was the magazine. I'm looking at Warren, and I put the magazine down, and there's Elvis right there looking right in my face. I go, "Oh!" I said, "Oh, my God." I said, "You scared the hell out of me. You know that?" And he started, he was so sweet. He just started laughing. He was tickled. But I have to tell you that we looked at each other like, hey. You know, I looked like his younger brother, who was not as good looking as his older brother. And the girls would want to get to know me so they could get to know him. That's what it looked like. And he sensed it too, I know it. And I ran back next door and said, "Hey, Elvis is next door." And I was already doing his voice for TV. And they all said, "Oh, go back, talk to him, see if you can get him to come in." I ran back and he was at the counter talking to Frank DeCova, who was the chief on F Troop. And Joe Esposito met me and he said, "Oh, I'm sorry, Elvis is really in a rush, he can't." And I said to him, "Could you bring him next door for just a minute? I'm singing there and I want to do him." He said, "Wait a minute." He says, "Do you do Elvis?" And I said, "Well, I'm his voice for TV." And he said, "Wow." He says, "You really look like him." He said, I'm so sorry, we can't." And he said goodbye to Frank DeCova, and they left. They walked out the door. And he looked back at me. Wow. That's something to carry around. And to know that he thought it was you. "I usually don't do this. I'm going to give you one more. You want the real kicker? Okay." In 1974, after he knew about me, and Charlie had told him, if you listen to his live album From Graceland, from Memphis, Tennessee, you listen to the last song of the concert. It's Can't Help Falling in Love. Elvis sings, "Wise men say, only fools rush in." Okay. "Take my hand, take my whole life too." Okay, here comes the bridge. "Like a river flows, surely to the sea, darling, so it goes. Some things, you know, Pete, are meant to be. Some things, you know, Pete, are meant to be." You go back and listen to that. He didn't say Billy Bob. He didn't say Roy Orbison. And he didn't say a lot of people. But it touches my heart and my memory and my walk to know that somehow Elvis acknowledged me. That's a treasure that I get to carry. If I'm going to get old and look like this, I got to have a few treasures. I just shared them with you. As you can see, I'm the old Elvis. I'm what Charo would have looked like if he lived. I'm what Elvis might have looked like in his 70s. I don't know. I don't know about that. But here it is in my white glory. You ready? Here, wait a second. Wait a second. I got the glasses right here. You want Elvis in his 70s? There it is, baby. There's the king. Here I am, honey. I'm back. You see that? I know you have. If you're an Elvis fan, they had a video on a guy in Graceland that they said was Elvis. You know, come on. I just showed you Elvis. But he was a preacher, I think, from Arkansas. A real nice guy. And he had sort of a look, and it he drove everybody crazy for a minute. So anyway, there's my old Elvis for you. And I throw that out because I got a buddy, Dean Z. What a nice kid. Very talented. Does so much stuff. And he does the three phases of Elvis. He does early, black leather, and then the jumpsuit. By the way, Dean, your friend's jumpsuit looks great. And you're blessed that you can pull that off. In the 80s, I used to do that. I had a three costume change show I used to do. I'll show you the pictures in a minute. But, Dean, don't go white-headed. Will you leave me alone? I'm trying to make a living. My wife and I need some hamburger money. You know what I mean? I'll be the old guy. You be everything else. And maybe we'll do a show together. I don't know about that yet either. I saw him working one night in Las Vegas, and I went backstage to tell him, man, you're wonderful. His way with a song and an audience, very talented young star. And he'll be doing it as long as he wants. It's that simple. Okay, we're talking about a hero. A gentleman, and that's not Dean, by the way, either. We're talking about another hero who inspired Dean and me and thousands, thousands. Bob Dylan said he was the greatest, and John Lennon said before Elvis there was nothing. And in some ways he was right. But in my life, the hero, the first hero, the big one, was my dad. He was so charming. He was just the best. He had a red skeleton personality about him. And he invented something in the 30s. He invented rating movies. And he worked for Parents Magazine. He would go out to Hollywood and he would give these awards to the stars. Usually the child stars. The people that he first worked with were Natalie Wood, Elizabeth Taylor, Mickey Rooney, Ronnie McDowell. And they loved him through the years. But they would take him around a lot and introduce him to the stars that were there at the time. And they'd send him his picture afterwards. And he hung them on the wall, of course. I said, oh my God, look at these. My dad knows all these people. I thought they were his friends. Well, it might have been PR. But it really gave me quite a bubble to look at and wonder. I'm going to show you the first one. This first star I'm going to show you is one of the biggest American icons in movie history. Certainly a legend and a star in the greatest magnitude. War movies, Western movies, John Wayne. Well, listen here, Pete. You keep your eye on the sparrow and maybe you'll do this one day too. I love John Wayne. I know a lot of controversy about Duke, but there's always mishaps and controversy. Let's just enjoy him. Let me give you another one. My dad grew up in New York City, and he used to know some very questionable characters. My dad was a good athlete. He used to play handball with a guy named Legs Diamond, quite a gangster. He'd give my dad $5 to play, and he'd have $20 bet on the game. Those, my dad and Legs against two other guys. He used to play baseball with a gangster named Dutchie Schultz. And my dad used to walk like this, you know, side to side. And I used to call him Farmer. When one day he was walking in the street and he heard, hey, Farmer! He turned around and said, Dutchie, how are you? He said, Phil, I haven't seen you in a long time. You okay? My dad said, yeah, I'm just, you know, kind of busy. He said, but Dutch, I'm reading a lot of stuff about you, man. You might want to get out of business. And he said, Phil, this isn't a business you get out of. And 2 weeks later, he was murdered in a restaurant. It was very, my dad was sad when he used to tell a story. But then there was another kid that he knew that was hanging out at Stillman's Gym, a place in New York City where fighters and showbiz people used to hang out. And they would give him like 20 bucks, you know, help him along because he was having a hard time. And through the years, he was kind of a buddy. And when my dad went to Hollywood, they were filming Never So Few, and he saw his old friend Frank Sinatra. And I was so tickled that Dad got to see him. Frank was so gracious to him that he sent all the albums that he had recorded on Capitol. So that's another lovely story. I got another 50s singer while we're talking about Italian singers. And this guy, to me, was always the most charming guy in show business. Movies, TV, records, Dean Martin. Everybody loves somebody sometime. I wanted to be Dean Martin. Matter of fact, I got to be Dean Martin for about 5 years. I was in a Rat Pack show, and that was it. I got to do Dean. It was kind of a fulfillment of a deal. I was Elvis. I didn't have to try to be Elvis. I was Elvis. But I wanted to be Dean. He was older. He was cooler than a tuxedo and, you know, had a glass of wine and a showgirl. Come on. All right. Here's another guy my dad took a liking to. They were pretty good buddies. And it all started with a mouse. And the mouse's name was Mickey. And that was Walt Disney. My dad was, we would get a Christmas card every year from Walt. And just as nice as he could be. He waited to find out when I was born. Is it a boy or a girl? Okay. And he sent to Peter Michael, best wishes, Walt Disney. And we still have it. It's a wonderful memento, a wonderful thing to have. But I met Walt when I was about 5. My dad took us out to California just that one time. And he walked me all around the studio. And believe me, I was a buzz bomb. I was nuts. And Walt got a kick out of me. And he said to Mom, Gene, do you mind if I use him in movies? And my mom said, are your children in movies? He said, oh, no, no, no. He said, oh, I shouldn't have said that, should I, Gene? And my mom says, and I still am angry at her for this. My mom says, we want him to grow up normal. Normal? Do I look like I made normal? Mom, Annette could have been my girlfriend, not Frankie Avalon. Me, I could. It's okay. I lived in an Italian neighborhood. There were Italian girls. She was cute, though. A lovely lady I met Annette. I had the honor of singing for her birthday. Okay, here comes a guy from the 50s that rocked my world. 1956, my dad calls up, Pete, I'm going to have lunch tomorrow with Pat Boone. Is that any good? Pat Boone, Dad, my God, he's a big star. That's great. He said, then at 2 o'clock, excuse me, 2 o'clock, I'm going to go by and see this kid. I think his name is Elvis Presley. Have you ever heard about him? Oh, my God. I started screaming. Are you kidding me? Oh, look at Elvis, how cute he is. That's from the movie Loving You. That's the shirt you wore when he sang Teddy Bear. And there's my dad playing ukulele. He said he just loved Elvis. He was such a sweet kid. Oh, you don't think this picture rocked my world? Surely did. When he came home, every year when my dad would come home from California, we'd have dinner with my aunt, and he'd tell us what everybody was like, and he said Elvis was just the sweetest guy ever. And so I'm taking in the dishes from the table, and my aunt says, Phil, what was Elvis like? And I'm behind the door, so I don't go in. And my dad says, you know, it's kind of like Pete had an older brother. How about that one? An older brother. I was just kind of frozen in my tracks. Mind you, I never wanted to be Elvis, and none of us do. None of the tribute acts want to be Elvis. But we do wish we were like him. We wish we could achieve what he did. That's what a hero is. He lifts you. He gives you inspiration. And that's what Elvis did. He also has such a legacy of work and memories that it's a real joy to perform them and share those memories. I don't make light of that. But I want you to know where Elvis truly is in our memory and in our hearts. He's a source of inspiration. And that is what Elvis was to me and still is to me. But we're talking about pictures that inspired. I saved this picture for the Hollywood guys till the end. When I was a boy, I used to love the swashbuckler movies, you know, Three Musketeers, Man in the Iron Mask, Robin Hood, Last of the Mohegans. I loved that one too. But my favorite was Don Juan, starring Errol Flynn. Well, here we go. Up on our wall was a picture of my dad and Errol Flynn. Look at that. I'm going to pick it all the way up here. Look at Errol Flynn. It's hanging on the wall. I say, Dad, that's Don Juan. He says, I know. Dad, what's he like? Well, my dad looked at me. He said, you know, he's a lot like you. Do you know what that did to me? Here's my hero, actually two of them, but my main hero telling me I'm like Errol Flynn. That opened the doors to dreams. That opened my mind to do anything I could do. Anything I wanted to do was possible. Well, there's two people to tell you that. Your family, the people love you. God tells you that. What you can dream, you can do. All things are possible. I put that out there because I want you all to keep trying. Keep trying, especially you young ETAs. It's out there. You never know where it's going, brother. Have fun with it. Okay. I graduated high school. I went in the Army. Became a singer. I'm going to tell you more about that as the weeks go by. So it's kind of story by story. But I wound up in Hollywood. I wound up at a place. That place that I was talking about, it was called Sherry's, next to Schwab's Drugstore. And the gentleman that played piano there and opened the door to me was a gentleman named Don Randy. Here's Don's picture. Don is the greatest rock and roll piano player of all time. He's played on everything Elvis did, the Beach Boys, everything Phil Spector did. He was Nancy Sinatra's arranger and conductor. And he was really the finest friend I ever had in that city. He did so much for me. He tried to help me. We put some songs together. Don was and is a doll, and I love him very much. And he was the one who went to dinner with Ron Hicklin. That was right. And Ronnie used to do all the voices for TV. He put them together, and they were having dinner. And Don also, by the way, I must tell you what I'm thinking about. He was the piano player in The Wrecking Crew. There's a lot of movies about that now, a documentary. So that's a name to put in your musical memory, Don Randy. But this fellow, that's how I got the job doing Elvis for TV. And I got to meet some wonderful people through that. Again, there's some more stories coming, but I'm trying to get to some of the wonderful things that happened to me through Hollywood. And I was called upon to do some TV shows. Once I did one, they just called me for all of them. Hollywood doesn't look around for a bunch of different times. Call the guy that did that show. We'll use him. Excuse me. And I got to show you, one of my favorite characters was Alf. I got to be his neighbor down the street. And he thought, I think Elvis is down the street. And it was so much fun. He was such a great guy. Not Alf, but, you know, the guy who did Alf. And he said, well, we sure wish you'd do a song for us, Pete. I said, I'd like to get a picture of Alf, too. So, oh, no, we don't do any pictures with Alf. I said, well, I'm going to sing a song. Okay, you're going to have a picture with Alf. So I feel very special about that. While I was doing this, I was also working in Las Vegas at Legends in Concert, which was the greatest tribute show in the history of tribute shows. And backstage one night, a guy comes by to say hello. I'll tell you know what I mean? I got no respect. I love you, Elvis, you know? Rodney, what a character. So much fun. The guy spilled more that night than I drank, but he was a great, great guy. So much fun, so encouraging, Rodney. Now, here's another guy that I love. Oh, my God, that I love. Still love him. the blue-eyed soul singer. The Righteous Brothers were amazing, and Don played on the Righteous Brothers, by the way. I love Bobby Hatfield. Bobby's a real sweet guy. He used to come by the baked potato. But this guy makes me nuts. Bill Medley. You're never closing eyes anymore. Love Bill. I wrote a song for Ray Charles called Hang Ups. I'll do that for you down the line. And Bill would threaten doing it. He said, I'll do that song if you work my club down there in Fountain Valley at the Hop. I said, okay. I worked the club. He never sang the song. It's okay. I hate to say it, Bill. It's all over now. They're coming to get you for the house. You're through, Bill. But God bless you. You had a nice life. Anyway, in the words of Don Rickles, I got a guitar player here that should rock your boat. Sure rock mine. I did a movie, and this guy was in it with me. James Burton. Oh my God, is this guy good? He's the country rock guitar player. We first noticed him. He was on a Ricky Nelson TV show. He used to play for Ricky. And when Elvis put his band together, he came to James and James, let's put the best band together in town. In town, maybe in the world. Ronnie Tutt on drums, Glenn D. Harden on the piano, Jerry Sheff on the bass. I did a session with James, and James came to my house and said, Pete, I'm going to put the band back together. Would you think about being the singer? James, have you gone crazy? Of course, I punched my mother in the face to be the singer. Oh, my God, it never happened. And I didn't punch my mom in the face either. But great, great guy. Wonderful fellow. I hope the world remembers James. They should. Here's another guy that I got to sing with one night. Story I'll elaborate again one time soon, but to just kind of get him out there and get him in there, how about Tom Jones? Tom Jones, to me, is the greatest rock and roll singer alive today. Just amazing. The voice keeps getting better. Last time I heard him, I started weeping. I couldn't believe how good he still sounds. You see him on The Voice in England, the show stops. Tom, would you sing one? All right, come on then. A buddy of mine was singing, and I went in a nightclub, and he was singing some Elvis songs. I said, oh, wait a minute. Tom Jones doesn't come and do Elvis songs, and I need to do something. And so my friend said, just take it easy. And he started singing, Are You Lonesome Tonight? You know, Tommy, Are You Lonesome Tonight? And they got to the talking part, and I'm looking at the guy, and he hands me the mic. Tom's about to lean in, and I said, I wonder if you're lonesome tonight. Lad, get up here with me. Come on. So that's what we did for about an hour. Tommy and I sang rock and roll together. It was a night from heaven. I'll never, ever forget it. A lot more goes with that story. That's coming. Okay. So I put together an Elvis show. And Dean, please play note here. I put together an Elvis show with multiple costumes. And here we go. It starts with a pink jacket. Elvis from 1954, 55, 56, come on. There it is. My mom made that jacket, by the way. She made most of my clothes. And then the jacket and the suit that he hated was his gold lame. Mom made that too. Okay. Then, and here's one you don't do, Dean. Elvis in the Army. Come on, look at that. I'm 19 years old in the Army playing guitar. Oh my God, that's really how I got my start. And I'll tell you that one day also, how I was in a service club and I started singing like Elvis and they went nuts. Well, then the next thing we see, you gotta have black leather, right? 68 comeback? Look at me coming back. Another suit my mom made. I'm keeping an eye on you, Zine. You better not be trying to steal my act on me. And then after that, I thought, well, let's sew the eagle on him. And this picture got me a lot of work. They used to use this down in Pigeon Forge on the highway. All right, now, but here's my favorite. This is my favorite Elvis picture. I mean, because who is Elvis but the rock and roll peacock, right? Look at that. Come on. How could this guy turn into this guy? It's not fair, is it? It's okay. I'm getting through it. Got a special little group here. I was down in Pigeon Forge, Tennessee for about a year and a half. It was right down the street from Dollywood, called a place called Memory Cedar. And remember I told you met Charlie at a party? Well, he was singing there. They had a fellow there and he left and they're looking for another Elvis tribute act. And I got to sing with Charlie. He was such a wonderful gent. When I got down there, he was down in the band dressing room with his tux hanging on a nail. I had a fit. I said, what the hell's the matter with you people? Charlie, get your stuff, get down in my room. What's the matter with you? And sometimes I'd be singing and he'd be following me around. He's following the Elvis character and he'd be holding my mic wire. And I'd stop the show. I say, folks, I want you to know that I'm doing a tribute to Elvis and I love it. But I want you to look here to my right. What a gentleman this is to help me, help make this show right and do for me what he did for his dear friend. I'm a tribute act, but Charlie is the real McCoy. Ladies and gentlemen, please say hello to my friend Charlie Hodge. Look at him. He's like a little Elvis doll, isn't he? And Charlie was so sweet. He would just take that with so much love. And then one night, who should stroll in and decide he wants to sing Lead Me, Oh Guide Me with Charlie and I? Look at this. J.D. Sumner. Oh my God, is this guy wonderful. Sweet man, wonderful voice. That right there is a picture of history for me. It's such an honor to stand with these men and pay tribute like we did to Elvis. It was great. Well, this next picture is a little tender for me, but I want to share it with you. It's a little out of focus, and I'm sorry about that, but we lost Dick Grohl. Dick was the head of security for Elvis. He met him in Palm Springs. He was a police officer and a very, very efficient one. Dick is funny. He's very much like Gary Cooper. Yep. Nope. Yep. That's the way Dick was. And I'll never forget one night, we were playing at a club in the San Fernando Valley. They weren't going to pay us. So Dick was in the he was in the kitchen with us, my manager and I. And we turned around and there's about eight cooks with butcher knives standing there. Dick steps between me and the cooks and goes, they scattered like birds, gone. That's why Elvis loved Dick. He was efficient, he was quiet, and he was wonderful. And after doing this, I'm sending out my love and my special appreciation to his dear wife, Melissa. She's a doll, and I'm so sorry. We'll all miss Dick. But through the years, you feel free to say hello to me anytime you want to, baby. I'm trying to reach her on the phone, and right now she needs some time to mend. But she was a doll as well. Okay, I got one more picture I'm going to share with you. This is a gentleman that I met at the Palomino. Always liked him. Real, real sweet man. Very, very friendly. Very encouraging. A list of songs like nobody's business. Friend of mine knew him and his manager, Kenny Rogers. Will you look at me? How young I was. Oh my God. I looked like I'm in high school. I wasn't. I was just very young. He came to see the show and God bless him. He was sweet as he could be. And I thought I'd like to do a couple of songs for you today. I'm almost through. I want to thank you again for the time you spent with me and shared with me. Oh, please let me direct you to my website while I'm at it. I have a website called PeteWilcoxShow.com. Wilcox is two L's. So it's Pete Willcox, W-I-L-L-C-O-X, show.com. And it has a lot of TV shows. It's got some original material on there that I'd like you to see. But I wanted to do this song, actually a little medley of some songs that Kenny did just to say hello and commemorate. That's a kind of hard word to say. Commemorate the music of Mr. Rogers. Let me see. Let me get the band kicked on here. I think there we are. I'm your knight in shining armor, and I love you. You have made me what I am, and I am yours. My love, there's so many ways I want to say I love you. Let me hold you in my arms forevermore. In my eyes, I see no one else but you. There's no love like our love. Yes, and I'll always want you with me. I've waited for you for so long. 'Cause my love, there's something I want. You're the love of my life. You're my lady. On a warm summer's evening, train bound from nowhere, met up with a gambler. We were both tired to sleep. We took turns staring out the window in the darkness. Boredom overcome us. He began to speak. He said, "Son, I made a living out of reading people's faces, knowing what the cards were by the way they held their eyes. You don't mind my saying, I can see your out of aces. For the taste of your whiskey, I'll give you some advice." So I handed him my bottle. He drank down my last swallow. Then he bummed a cigarette and he asked me for a light. The night got deathly quiet. His face lost all expression. "If you're gonna play the game, son, you got to learn to play it right. You got to know to know when to hold 'em, know when to fold 'em, know when to walk away, know when to run. You never count your money. Sitting at the table, there'll be time enough for counting. When the dealing's done, you got to know when to hold 'em, know when to fold 'em, know when to walk away, know when to run. You never count your money. Sitting at the table, there'll be time enough for counting when the deal is done." And then my favorite song from my sweet wife Linda, "My Little Bunny Eyes." While she lay sleeping, I stay out late at night and play my songs. And sometimes all the nights seem so long. It's good when I finally make it home, all alone. She lay dreaming I try to get undressed without the light. And quietly she says, how was your night? I come to her and say, it was all right. And I hold her tight. And she believes in me. God only knows just what she sees in me. I told her someday, if she was my girl, maybe I could change this world with my little songs. I was wrong, but she's got faith in me. And so I go on trying faithfully. And who knows, maybe on a special night, if my song is right, I'll find a way. She lives waiting. I stumble to the kitchen for a bite, and I see my old guitar in the night, just waiting for me like a secret friend. There's no end. She lays crying while I fumble for a melody or two. And I'm torn between the things that I should do. And she says, wake me up when you're through. Got out of this tree. She believes in me. God only knows just what she sees in me. I told her someday, if she was my girl, maybe I could.